Hi, I'm Ann Rieselbach, Program Director of the Architectural League. Welcome to the final night of presentations by the 2022 Emerging Voices. This series is made possible through the generosity of the program sponsors, and on behalf of the League, I'd like to thank longstanding principal supporters and enthusiasts, Elise Jaffe and Jeffrey Brown. Additional support for the Emerging Voices program is provided by public funds from the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs in partnership with the City Council, and by the Next Generation Fund of the Architectural League, supported by a group of past Emerging Voices and League prize winners. Architectural League programs are also supported, in part, by public funds from the New York State Council on the Arts with the support of the Office of the Governor and the New York State Legislature, as well as by members of the Architectural League. We ask that you please consider joining the League. Membership information is available on our website and through the link that was just posted or is about to be posted in the chat section. Once again, some background on the Emerging Voices program for any of the audience new to the series. The program was launched 40 years ago during the Architectural League's centennial as part of an ongoing commitment to recognize, nurture, and share the work of young and emerging architects and designers. The League Prize for Young Architects and Designers was founded in tandem with this program. And a quick program note, the 2022 lectures and installation by that competition's winners will launch in June. Each year, the Emerging Voices jury selects 8 practices based in the United States, Canada, or Mexico through an invited jury portfolio competition that recognizes talented individuals and firms with a distinct design voice and a body of accomplished work, from installations and community advocacy to explorations of fabrication methods and build commissions, often in combination, that has the potential to influence the disciplines of architecture, landscape architecture, and urbanism. Please visit the League's website to learn more about the over 300 past and recent winners and their work, including lecture videos and interviews. And each year we've expanded the scope of this coverage. A huge thanks goes out to the League staff members, Rafi Lehman, Sarah Wessler, Alicia Botero, and Anne Carlisle, who worked to bring all of the elements of this year's program to fruition, from the competition logistics to the publicity and editorial features. The jury examined accomplished examples of the breadth of contemporary architectural practice during the two-step process of selecting this year's winners. First, evaluating work, CVs, and design statements from about 50 firms. They then met online to review more extensive and truly outstanding portfolios from about 20 finalists to select the 8 2022 Emerging Voices. We're grateful for the time and expertise of the 2022 jury, Paul Lewis, Zach Mortis, Mark Neveu, Rashida NG, Shalina Odbert, Susan Scott, Saidi Springnell, Sarah Zoide, and tonight's program moderator, Ursula Kripa. Ursula is co-director of the firm Agency, a collaborative interdisciplinary practice engaging contemporary culture through architecture, urbanism, and advocacy. She is the director of the College of Architecture at Texas Tech University in El Paso, and is director of projects at the POST Project for Operative Spatial Technologies, and the College of Architecture's Research Center. She also serves on the editorial board of the Journal of Architectural Education. Ursula will introduce each of tonight's speakers, and after their presentations, we'll follow up with a conversation with Azra and Sekou. She will also pass along questions from the audience, which should be posted in the Q&A section, not in chat, please. And finally, information about CEUs will be provided in the chat section towards the end of the presentations. Thank you.
Hello. Thank you, Anne, for the introduction, and thank you all for being here tonight. I wish we could be in person, but here we are. And so tonight we will see the work of Azra Akšamija and Sekou Cooke. I will go ahead and introduce both of them, and then we will watch their presentations. Azra Akšamija is an associate professor at MIT, where she's the director of the Art, Culture, and Technology Program and the director of the MIT Future Heritage Lab. And some of that work you will see tonight. She holds a PhD from MIT's Department of Architecture, an MArch from Princeton, and an architecture diploma from Technical University of Graz in Austria. Her work has been widely recognized. She's published in books, journals, has exhibited at many venues, including the Venice Biennale, and was awarded the Aga Khan Award for Architecture, and the list goes on. But most importantly, Azra's work is directly rooted in her own background, which she will share a bit about today. In design practice, as it impacts lives at many scales, it is important to inhabit one's world in empathy. And this empathy in her work comes from her firsthand experience of discrimination and genocide. This lived empathy propels her to other contexts of similar conflict and guides her work in fundamental ways. I'm very touched to be able to watch her present today. And then that presentation will be followed by Sekou Cooke, who is an architect, urban designer, researcher, and curator. He's born in Jamaica and is based in Charlotte, North Carolina, where he's the director of the Master of Urban Design program at UNC Charlotte. And he's a founding member of the Black Reconstruction Collective. Founded in 2008, Sekou Cooke Studio has completed design commissions and projects across the United States and internationally. His work, as Azra is, has been published and recognized widely, most recently in the very important exhibition, Reconstructions, Architecture and Blackness in America at the Museum of Modern Art. Sekou's research practice centers on the emergent field of hip-hop architecture, a theoretical movement reflecting the core tenets of hip-hop culture with the power to create meaningful impact on the built environment and to give voice to the marginalized and underrepresented within design practice. Sekou's work questions, whom does architecture serve and whom should it serve? His writing and research expand upon his built work and offers alternatives to the accepted norms of the discipline and to its protective boundaries, and explodes them wide open for an inclusive and collaborative mode of practice. Please help me welcome, in your own remote virtual way, Azra and Sekou, and we will follow with discussions.
Good evening. It is a great pleasure to be here tonight, and thank you to the Architectural League of New York for giving me the honor of being part of this Emerging Voices program. My name is Azra Akšamija. I'm an artist and architectural historian. My work explores how social life is affected by the cultural destructions in the context of conflict, migration, and forced displacement. My presentation tonight will explore ways in which architecture can be a vehicle to counter conflict and crisis, and I will be presenting a couple of selected projects that I hope will prompt some questions for our joint discussion later. As we are witnessing the targeted murder of civilians and the massive destructions of cities and cultural heritage in Ukraine, Syria, Yemen, and other places, the long history of architecture's instrumental role in cultural warfare comes to mind. What is different in this current moment from these destructions in the past is the massive scale of destruction. What remains the same is that those who target people see architecture as a weapon that is powerful enough to destroy communities' livelihood and increase emotional suffering. I come from Bosnia and Herzegovina, a country that suffered a genocide and the ethnic cleansing during the 1990s. In my scholarly research, I studied the destruction of architecture and how it offered means to annihilate historical traces of communities designated for erasure. While all ethnic groups in Bosnia and Herzegovina were tragically affected by the war, it was the Bosnian Muslim population that was predominant target of the genocide and thus suffered the greatest human and architectural loss. The deliberate and systematic destruction of cultural heritage was an important instrument in this war, and the destruction was not only aimed at mere removal of ethnic symbols from landscape. I documented a form of sadism on architecture that was meant to ultimately alienate people to such an extent that would forever extinguish their desire to live together in the future. Here you see example of such a case in Foča, a town in eastern Bosnia, where all of the city's mosques were destroyed during the 1990s war. The Al-Aqsa Mosque was a pearl of Ottoman architecture, a protected monument that was shelled deliberately and then leveled to the ground. And a lot of work must have gone into the removing of the rubble and really digging out even the foundation stones and the graves that are surrounding the mosque. In many cases, like in Focha, the rubble was moved to unknown locations to prevent possible reconstructions in the future. Here, the rubble stones were later found on top of a mass grave, burying the bones and stones of the city's Muslim inhabitants, as if human bodies and architecture were the same. My work attempts to counter the destructive forces of war and explore potentials for social healing through architecture. And that healing begins with the facing of the facts, and the facts that the genocide happened in Bosnia beyond the only recognized, internationally recognized massacre in Srebrenica are still being negated and swept under the rug. Here you see an earlier work of mine called A Monument in Waiting from 2008, a woven wool carpet depicting stories of 9 mosques that were deliberately destroyed during the war in Bosnia. Woven into the carpet are symbols that are transcoding traditional carpet iconography into symbols of war, but also you see here in this Tree of Life motif certain code that is kind of indicating data, and this data is linked to a larger archive of photographs and interviews that I documented during my fieldwork in Bosnia, basically examining around 100 mosques. The carpet was woven by women survivors of torture camps for whom weaving offers a form of trauma recovery. The carpet is on the top left intentionally open to indicate that more stories need to be documented and told. And this project is waiting to become a monument once the facts of the genocide have been acknowledged and recognized by all sides involved. Much of my subsequent work was informed by my personal experiences as a secular Muslim woman growing up in Bosnia and then living in exile in Austria. And the cultural biases I witnessed during my life in Austria. Trained as an architect, I was intrigued by the way in which architectural arguments such as this building is not suitable for the local context and the zoning regulations were in fact disguising xenophobic undertones of debates around visibility and presence of Muslim migrants in Europe. The many mosque, anti-mosque protests that we witnessed across Western Europe and United States prompted me to continue exploring politics of architectural representation. And the struggle over what type of mosque would be really suitable or acceptable for a Western European or American city is really a struggle over a question of who has the right to be visible in public space and who makes these decisions. I believe that architecture can be a powerful tool to unpack such critical questions. Ultimately, this inquiry led me to a body of work themed as wearable mosques. Individual clothing items that represent minimal portable prayer spaces, which can easily switch from religious to secular functions. Here you see a piece called the Dirndl Moshe, inspired by Austrian traditional costume, whose apron unfolds into a prayer rug for 3 people. The project deconstructs visually the notions of homogeneous entities such as Islam or the West, or the Austrian nation, and breaks them down to the scale of a person. And each person, as we know, has multiple, multi-layered, fluid, and oftentimes contradictory identities. In 2016, I founded the MIT Future Heritage Lab, an experimental hub of artists, architects, and urban planners, operating across Boston, Amman, Nicosia, Beirut, with an outreach to refugee camps in Jordan. We work on connecting the concerns of forced displacement with concerns of historic preservation to advocate for people-centered approaches in both realms using methods of socially engaged participatory art. Our work addresses a range of ethical concerns around cultural warfare, For example, questions like how do we talk about the destruction of cultural heritage without the use of those carefully choreographed imagery of violence, which is meant to enhance the impact of destruction? Or what does it mean to mourn the destruction of a World Heritage site when millions of Syrians are suffering, being killed and forcefully expelled? How is it that the world was more enraged and shocked by the destruction of Palmyra than the destruction of the Great Mosque of Aleppo, which is also a World Heritage Site? And how does one empathize with the suffering of people and cultural losses in those locations that might be geographically and culturally very distant to us? In terms of preservation, we ask also how useful is technology in addressing these concerns. We know that digital fabrication and photogrammetry offer very tempting possibilities for cultural preservation that would enable us to document and recover a lost heritage almost simultaneously as the destruction takes place. But owning these technologies doesn't automatically imply that one can use them without caution. Think, for example, of some of the colonial dynamics being perpetuated in the touring of the 3D printed Palmyra arch in capitals of imperial power. And does one consider the local expertise in Syria? Here you see an image of a Syrian man from Daraa building a model of Palmyra in the Za'atari refugee camp in Jordan using mud and kebab sticks. He's a part of a group that founded a workshop in the camp where they build models of their heritage as a way of remembering the past. Such humanitarian efforts to involve cultural heritage for social healing are certainly powerful in addressing emotional needs of displaced people, but they often also do play into the nostalgic approach to cultural heritage, one that can so easily be instrumentalized for purposes of nationalism and that does not consider the dimension of living heritage and living cultural practices of displaced Syrians. The Future Heritage Lab deals with these difficult questions. In 2016, I conceived a project called Memory Matrix, a monument in the constant process of construction and destruction. The project is an anamorphic projection of the Palmyra Arch, which has been previously destroyed by ISIS in 2015, prompting this international outcry and intense debate in the preservationist communities about who will get to restore it and how. The matrix consists of 20,000 little neon acrylic elements or pixels hung from chain link fencing. They are laser cut with holes outlining monuments that were destroyed during the participants' lifetime. And they indicate some sort of personal connection of people across the world to this larger story depicted in the matrix. For example, one of the stories depicted is the synagogue, Great Synagogue of Munich, which had been destroyed by the Nazis during the Kristallnacht pogrom in 1938. And the pixel was designed by one of my students whose grandmother was a Holocaust survivor. As I mentioned, the outlines of the matrix are designed by various project participants. They were in total around 700 people who participated in this project in various locations in various capacities, from classes and students at MIT to workshops at the Cairo Makeup Fair, Amman Design Week, and International Art Academy in Palestine. During these memory matrix workshops, participants depict outlines of the chosen monuments from their memory, and then these hand-drawn outlines are translated, digitized, and precisely laser cut. In the one-to-one conversations, stories around these monuments are being exchanged and knowledge transfer happens. In some of the workshops, also the cutouts were used to create jewelry and keychains, little portable embodiments of memory. The materials and the form of this project evoke the entanglement of forced displacement with the destruction of cultural heritage. Instead of the border fences that we find erected all over the world to prevent refugees from entering, the peace multiplies the fences to form a gateway, and a gateway that invites the visitor to engage with the pixels and the stories depicted in them, to pause and think whether they want to steal one or maybe try to repair the monument that is constantly shedding pixels because they are shattered by wind. And should they decide to repair, this inevitably begs the question of what is actually being restored. If there is one lesson that I have learned from studying institutional and bottom-up approaches to restoration of cultural heritage in post-war contexts, that is that these restoration processes offer an opportunity for social recovery. And this means that restoring material dimensions of cultural heritage needs to go hand in hand with social restoration. Here you see an example of a successful material reconstruction of the old bridge in Mostar, which was destroyed in T2 and rebuilt thanks to the enormous effort of and expertise of a range of international agencies, including UNESCO. The bridge was restored using original building stones and techniques, and the stones had to be fished out of the river, which was a huge effort and logistics of its own. And all that effort went into the construction of this bridge because it was such an important monument, and not only important icon of Ottoman architecture, but also because it was a symbol of coexistence. However, the reconstruction here process missed out the opportunity for social reconstruction. The bridge today is an empty symbol without repercussions in the social realm. In Mostar, you have Muslim and Bosnian Croat students learning two versions of the shared history. And this notion of social reconstruction led me to bring our work to the Syrian refugee camps in Jordan. Since 2017, we have been conducting a range of projects in Azraq and Zaatari refugee camps. These are enormous camps on the scale of cities, housing, in the case of Azraq, 35,000 and in Zaatari, 90,000 people. Contrary to the rich Western countries, Jordan has been one of the most generous countries when it comes to accommodating and welcoming refugees. Majority of refugees in Jordan live in cities and only 10% live in these camps. And these places represent very special zones where the kind of cutting edge of international humanitarian design is displayed, where all that money is kind of, and where it goes can be observed in its full complexity. The common characteristic is placement of these camps in very remote locations, which prevents people from having a possibility of mixing with host population. There are also restriction of movement, which represent violations of human rights, and also general life in scarcity and hopelessness without access to work and education. In these timeless zones, we went to learn from displaced Syrians and what role cultural heritage and art play in their life. And you see here a powerful image of that, a sand castle designed by a Syrian resident of the Azra camp, and this image shows such a powerful juxtaposition of two concepts of a shelter. Shelter in the back in the form of a secure steel caravan provided by the international humanitarian aid agencies. And then the shelter in the front, a fragile sand sculpture reminiscent of the Palmyra arch and the local architectural heritage. The former outlines an approach to defining essential human needs based on biological needs for safety, roof above the head, food and water. The latter positions the notion of the essential human need in the cultural and emotional realm. Over the past 5 years, we have been documenting such examples of refugee inventions, which pointed the way in which art, design, and cultural preservation can be used to humanize humanitarian aid. Aside from various utilitarian inventions, such as DIY conditioners and water carts, Azra Camp residents use and reuse humanitarian inventions and humanitarian aid to as a resource to address those needs that are not met, their cultural and emotional needs. Here you see an example of a majlis on the left, a multifunctional living room where the so-called core relief items such as wool blankets and the plastic sheets were carefully crafted to create a welcoming environment for hosting of guests in a complete absence of social spaces. Another example is this water fountain that is used to create an experience reminiscent of a home in Syria. The fountain was designed by Abu Jar, a man from Syria who lives in Azra Camp, whose work plays with the actual and possible relations of available objects. The set of buckets is utilized as a container of water and podium at the same time. The shisha stem serves as the piping system to pump the water from the bucket container all the way up to the gasket. And when the winter arrived, the fountain turns back into shisha and the set of buckets without the functionality of the individual items being basically compromised. The reversibility of this device is intelligent concession to resource scarcity at the camp. With the Future Heritage Lab team, we have been studying and reverse engineering these inventions together with our students at MIT and our collaborating partners at the German Jordanian University in Amman, humanitarian agency CARE, and a group of young Syrians living at the camp. This work was documented in our book, Designed to Live, published by the MIT Press, which shows how refugees use art and design to transform their living environments, restoring humanity within circumstances that deprive them from it. In an age of global transformation, this book shows the agency of design as a language of closeness and collaboration towards a collective future. The book can be read both from right to left and left to right, depending on the perspective of people living and working in the camp or people reaching out to study the camp. It is important for us here to mention that the book outlines the methods of how large a group of people can essentially combine their skills and collaborate across borders. The ethics of working in such fragile environments is a central concern that informed every decision in our process, from committing to work as transdisciplinary and transgenerational group, and also always connecting people from the Syrian community, members of the host community, Jordanians and Palestinians, as well as international students. And everyone is kind of learning and teaching something at the same time. And this work transpired into a more design-related proposition, such as this piece called T-Serai, here installed in an installation at the Venice Architecture Biennale last year, titled Displaced Empire, where we contemplate the world in which majority of population has become displaced, basically, and what kind of world might that be if it was governed by different power relationships. This palace is inspired by both precedents we found in Azra refugee camp, the humanitarian UNHCR shelter, and also the Ottoman military palace that used to be made in elaborate applique technique. So in its shape and size and title, it alludes to these precedents, reversing the making process to probe different performance of textiles in the context of displacement. On the one hand, kind of looking at the environmental, social, footprint of all these clothing donations that are partly culturally inappropriate that arrive in these camps, and you know, it might be your and mine items of clothing that we kind of consume here and discard, that have huge impact on the environment in remote places on the world. So the commentary on the kind of the world's most lucrative and largest polluting industries is part of the project, but also looking into ways in which the manufacturing and construction can incorporate measures to ensure economic viability and environmentally sustainable approach to developing humanitarian aid projects and architecture. So the construction of these tapestries requires minimum and low-tech infrastructure, and the modular approach allows for crowdsourcing of tent panels for the creation of collective spaces, which are then designed by layering different fabrics on top of each other in a reverse applique technique. The making could offer livelihood opportunity for Syrian refugees, but also possibilities for thermal comfort, and a kind of modularity is here evoked as a system that would also enable socially inclusive systems, that collective spaces could be potentially formed using these types of cultural tools. On the making level, the project involved workshops that took place from MIT, American University in Sharjah, Zaatari Refugee Camp. These workshops were about education in and about crisis zones, and also, you know, using textile art. Students were invited to document their stories, but also learn about each other, going beyond the cultural appropriation and nationalist nostalgia, but in thinking about cultural preservation, but really researching the ways in which artists and craftspeople can use textile art to transfer their knowledge across generations, document untold stories, and communicate political messages. And finally, we use this work to as a kind of expression of a possibility for transcultural encounter, but also preserving memory for population of the move, bringing forth dialogical dimensions of patterns between regions to promote knowledge transfer, and to promote new ethical standards for social inclusive art and design in zones of crisis. This type of work offers a critical response to the dehumanizing impact of one-size-fits-all solution for refugee camps that are masked with a guise of efficiency. We hope to design innovative processes and practices that would defy the lack of agency connected to statelessness and conditions of displacement. Thank you.
Alert the squad. Rock roll, huh? Alert the squad. Rock roll,
huh? Thanks everyone for coming out. Alert the squad. Thanks Rachel and Zach for that introduction.
Thanks Catherine for that introduction, and
thanks Ben for the introduction, and thanks for that introduction, Jason. That was really quite eloquently put.
Thanks again for the warm introduction and just the general warm welcome from everyone here. I am descendants of the builders of your street. Black people, tenders to your cotton money. I am hip-hop. But I will be talking about hip-hop architecture, because that's kind of the number one question most people have. So Elvis Presley ain't got no soul. Chuck Berry is rock and roll. You may dig on the Rolling Stones, but
they ain't come up with that style on their own. Elvis Presley ain't got no soul.
Hell no.
Little Richard is rock and roll.
Right.
You may dig on the Rolling Stones, but they ain't come up with that shit on their own. Guess that's just the way it goes. Steal my clothes and try to say they yo.
Yes, they do.
Business is so filled with pimps and hoes. Trying to take everything that you made in control.
There they go.
Elvis Presley ain't got no soul. Bo Diddley is rock and roll.
Rock, hell, right.
You made it on the Rolling Stones. But they ain't the first place the credit belongs. Say, whoa, oh, gon' take it. Oh, we, oh, back to
rock, say,
whoa, oh, gon' take it.
One of the main reasons I wrote this book is to just answer all the questions people kept having. So the number one thing that any author wants you to do is not to buy their book, is to actually read the book. So I don't care if you steal the book or get it from a library somewhere, but I want you to read it so that you can engage with me on the topic, right? Yeah, so the first volume is a kind of introduction to all of the theories. It starts with a disclaimer. The second volume is really laying down most of the theory, the history and theory of hip hop architecture as a topic. The third volume is where you see most of the work. This is like the imagery. This is all of the contemporary practices that are happening that are influenced directly by hip hop architecture. And then the fourth volume is what I call the B-sides, all the speculations and tangents, all the things that are somehow connected to hip hop architecture, but aren't hip hop in a more intentional form. So what is it? That's the first main question, right? What is hip hop architecture? And if we start to understand architecture as being one of the primary modes of cultural expression, then we understand that hip hop architecture is not just this secondary thing. It's not just something that we're coming up with as maybe it's possible, but it's necessary, right? And the short elevator pitch quote is that hip-hop architecture is hip-hop culture in built form. So this is from Andres Hernandez. This is a document he produced in 1998 at a NOMA conference that was in Miami. And you can see he came up with this 10-point platform for what he was calling hip-hopitecture at the time. You can compare that with what happens with Craig Wilkins, who's also done some really extensive writing on hip-hop architecture, where these are his four rules for what it needs to be. It needs to be palimpsestic, anthropomorphic, performative, adaptive. So what does it look like? That's the big question that most people have. Like, what does it look like? If I see a hip-hop building, can I tell it's a hip-hop building? At the time, I'd been doing this research for about 3 or 4 years, and the question kept coming up. So I'm like, okay, here's an entire exhibition of about 30 or 40 pieces by 20 or 30 people who have been thinking about this for the last 26 years. Okay, so this is the exhibition that you may have seen images of. And it gave a really great opportunity to explore that from a 2D and a 3D experience. And then it moved to St. Paul, Minnesota, later the next year, and got remixed and reformulated. But the installation, the design of the space was also part of that thesis, part of that idea of what might it look like.
Right.
So this is just all the pretty pictures that I was promising you. But again, all of these are in the book. These are images or projects done by students, by theorists, by practitioners. Some of them are speculative, some of them are installed, some of them are real, some of them are works done by graffiti artists who have become architects or have been working with architects and who are working in many, many different ways.
The way that we use public space is really the way that we express freedom, and in freedom is joy, and in joy is ultimate self-preservation and self-care.
So the story of Syracuse is the story of almost any town USA when it comes to understanding the history of Blackness in America. And so the 15th Ward was an area of thriving growth for the Black community in Syracuse. And then a few years later, this is what it looked like. So most of the
that area was cleared out and most of those people were displaced. So as we look at this aerial photograph, what we're seeing here is I-81 cutting through the center of the city. And you can see the highway actually cuts through the center of the public housing project itself. So they, you know, on the Blueprint 15 website, they have this quote about Atlanta's East Lake, which is such a huge example of success. But what's happened in East Lake, if you know anything about the history there, only about 22% of the residents were able to come back after they had been displaced. So that idea helped me to grab onto a couple of these quotes that I'll show you in a second that are about this history of placement and displacement that has been the history of Black people in this country. And then the second quote from The Wire, this is from season 3, episode 1, where they're tearing down the public housing project that used to be their home and also where they would sell drugs, of course. But it's that, you know, they're gonna tear this down, they're gonna build something else, but people, they don't really give a fuck about people. And then we were able to uncover some of these historical drawings, these early drawings of Pioneer Homes and McKinney Manor. And if you look closer, you'll see these dotted lines are outlines of tenement houses that used to be there before that were torn down and replaced with the public housing project with Pioneer Homes. So then what I did was basically overlap all of these layers of history, overlap and intersect them. So what you're seeing in orange are the areas of intersection of all these layers of buildings that used to be on the site. And these now create a new landscape of the public sphere, the public space that is between buildings. And they're meant to be informal follies for informal entrepreneurial activities or recreation or other kinds of uses that are typical, that sometimes get criminalized within Black communities. And then the big white rectangles are placeholders for a kind of imagined banal design that would be done by purpose-built communities that wouldn't be too dissimilar from the East Lake projects. Mm-hmm. And the last layer to elevate this from mere drawing an image to something that's more of an art piece is re-inscribing or screen printing over on top of these drawings, the historical drawings that we had found and uncovered in the research process. And this is what it looks like in the MoMA show itself. And then you see some of the quotes that I talked about before are re-inscribed in these drawings. And then I sacrificed the stoop from my old house in Syracuse and then built this base of laminated plywood that also is thinking about a kind of middle scale of subtraction. So the stoop is the 1-to-1 scale. There are these smaller scale models that are 3D printed and laser cut and assembled. And then the in-between scale is the plywood. And then this little chunk of concrete that when put together is reminiscent of what's happening at the smaller scales in the drawings and in the model. And this is how it all came together in the exhibition. I'm always an advocate that architecture and design should be about people.
But this project I can talk about that I've been working on for well over 2 years and might be another 2 years before it actually gets built, but this is the Syracuse Hip Hop Headquarters building.
Here we go. So I'm trying to remember, Sekou and I first got involved with each other through another project, but in the process for Good Life, the vision was to create a space as we outgrew, so our programs were continuing to grow, we were starting to serve more youth, and it was like we needed a building that spoke to the approach that we were taking with kids.
Hassan runs the Good Life Youth Foundation in Syracuse, which provides resources, education, and business opportunities to at-risk youth. He envisions the rundown former dairy building on Tully Street as a perfect new center for the foundation. The plans for the center include space for the foundation's growing youth programs, events, business incubation, and possibly apartments. Hassan and Sekou just need to fix up a few things first.
The clean out's gonna be a really fun experience.
And when it's all said and done, the walls will be a blank canvas, but not for long.
Anything that's concrete or things that we found here, but we're not gonna touch, we're gonna have a new graffiti crew come in and just bomb the whole place. Crews from all over the state, all over the country, all over the world can come in and once a year just go at all of these public parts of the space.
Tully, the hip-hop center for youth entrepreneurship, is not just a building for us to engage youth. It's deeper than that. This building is about identity. Imagine kids walking into a building that speaks to them, that has their culture, that they feel ownership of. And then it's also opportunity. It's those two things. It's identity and purpose together.
The vision was to create a space as we outgrew, so our programs were continuing to grow, we were starting to serve more youth, and it was like we needed a building that spoke to the approach that we were taking with kids. And so I was looking for buildings all over the city, and I happened to have a meeting in this area and drove by the building and just slammed on my brakes, and I was like, this is it. When I think about Syracuse, and whenever I'm talking to people, I ask them, can you name a building in Syracuse or anything that speaks to the youth and the culture that they understand? And every single time, people go silent, right? There's nothing that embraces hip hop. There's nothing that identifies with hip hop. And so that's why we wanted to do this building. It almost becomes like a living museum. Graffiti is live, it's living. That's what people have to understand, is that this is an identity for people. People relate to this. I could not be who I am, and I cannot define myself without hip hop. I grew up in hip hop. But it's almost a kind of an ironic thing, because they don't fully know about their culture. And so it's like with any culture, if the elders aren't teaching the youth about their culture, then it's gonna be interpreted however society interprets it, right? And so we're trying to bring that back, that information, that knowledge about the history, where it came from.
So part of what I'm striving for is understanding what is the core of that hip hop culture, how does it express itself through architecture, and what are all the other kind of relationships between the two. So I'll talk a little bit now about hip hop technology. This starts with this quote from Harry Allen, where he's talking about how hip hop has this power to humanize technology and make it tactile. We can think about and reflect back on the hip hop DJ and think of them as the original hackers of technology, and turning something as commodified as a phonograph, a turntable, and transforming it into a musical instrument by doing the one thing that you're never supposed to do, which is put your fingers on the records. Later on in the mid 90s to the early 2000s, Jay Dilla took that to a whole nother level. Obviously he's using a lot more technology than just turntables. You can see a laptop in the background, and may even spot a synthesizer and an old school iPod.
Part of the thesis comes from Amiri Baraka, his description of a typewriter. You know, he's talking about here, why should it just be this thing that it's only using the tips of our fingers? If I were creating a machine that's an expression scriber, if you will, then you, the kind of instrument I would step or sit or sprawl or hang, use not only my fingers, but make words, express feelings, but elbows, feet, head, behind, and all the sounds I wanted, screams, grunts, taps, itches. And you know, a typewriter is corny.
So 3D turntables, which is the original research project that I did, was funded by a grant from Autodesk. We started with these 3D printers, these really cheap monoprice printers. They're about $200 a piece. And we went through about three or four of them, kept breaking them, changing them. And this is what my studio looked like for a little bit. The basic idea was that we're going to disrupt the process of these printers. You see, it had a nozzle that went left to right and a bed that went front to back and went up. So we would actually, for the scratch, we would actually either shift the nozzle as the material is coming out, or shift the bed as the material is coming out. So we start out with these primitives, this basic cube. It's like an inch and a half by inch and a half cube. And so when we shift it, you'd get some results like this, or in the opposite direction like this. And sometimes we'd try testing out printing it with the fill only, or with the shell only. And then the spin was a different thing, where we would actually have to create a new bed on top of the original print bed and rotate that. Right, so now we start getting results that look more like this. They're no longer orthographic. They're now shifting against each other. And the crossfade is the last one, where we're actually running those three printers at the same time, stopping them simultaneously, switching them across from each other, and then playing again. So you start to get out prints like this. But then to apply that into practice, into real life, we have to test it at full scale somehow. These are derelict buildings on the south side of Syracuse, where I was at the time, and they're all over the place. And these are buildings slated for demolition. So what if the demolition process can become a performative act that allows these things to become temporarily useful or beneficial along the way? So the proposal now is this thing that is shifting and turning and actually cutting through the building at different levels, shifting it off axis. So, as I said at the beginning, I'll talk about two different projects that this approach has created or been tested in, either formally or operationally, procedurally. So the first one is much more formally generated. It's called ADUs ones and twos. And it started with a project by the LADBS, the Los Angeles Department of Building and Safety. And they had a new program for developing standard plan accessory dwelling units, ADUs, for the city of Los Angeles. And so I decided to reappropriate or reuse some of the formal ideas, formal logics from 3D turntables in designing these ADUs, like this. So here you can see a kind of prototypical house in the front and a prototypical backyard where this ADU would be situated, and you can see it shifting off the axis. And this is what it starts to look like three-dimensionally within the LA landscape.
You know, even Michael Brown and Ferguson basically got shot for crossing the street in the wrong place, right?
And this is a project, has been an ongoing project by David Brown, now applied to the Chicago Architecture Biennial. And it's about looking at all of the empty lots that exist across Chicago, the city of Chicago. The interesting part of that clip for me from Most Def's A Soldier's Dream is this, this discussion of this fabric, this weave that is a grid in essence, but is reminiscent of these other gridded forms across the city: elevated train tracks, tombstones. The first confrontation
between the Black body and the grid was in the slave ship gully, which is about efficiency. And it continued through slave quarters and through public housing. The griot, who is a figure in West African culture, who was a storyteller, an entertainer, and also a kind of keeper of the oral legacies of a community. As part of the Available City Project, the Chicago Architectural Biennial Project, David Brown was very interested in not just selecting architects and giving them a site to design something from scratch. He really wanted to partner community organizations that owned land with specific architects. And so what we started with on this empty lot is actually two lots, side a 50-foot double lot just south of this shipping container area, which was already being used by Y-men to store bikes. It's like what they call it, their bike box, where they store bicycles, they lend out bicycles, have tutorials to help people know how to fix bicycles. And that was one starting point. The other starting point we had was this color palette that they had developed with a graphic designer to paint the outside of that shipping container site. We decided to start with a new 40-foot container. So we're now amplifying what's already there instead of bringing something completely new to the scene. And then thinking about chopping this up, slicing this up in a non-orthogonal way, breaking the grid in any way we can, spreading that out to allow for occupation in one way, and then taking the tops off of some of these pieces and spreading them out across the site to now create a new kind of organization of occupiable program across the site. And then the last part of this, which was really important, was in a couple ways, first to anchor down some of the pieces onto the ground and also to re-inscribe this reference grid back onto the ground are these concrete pads. And so here we can see some of the programming, benches, seating, gathering areas, a performance space, a couple retail sheds, and then some planter areas. And on the top left is some additional bike storage for Y-men organization. And so the fabrication was relatively easy, actually surprisingly easy. All we had to do was order the shipping container, have it delivered to the Cochrane group in Chicago, who would then just literally chop it up and use their forklifts to pull it apart. Site. They were delivered to the site and placed in exactly the locations that they needed to be. We had this great help from the Y-men organization that brought out all these kids, actually paid them for their time and effort. Most of them had never painted anything before, but we used them as we wanted them to be involved and invested and feel ownership of the project. This is just right after assembly, the first assembly. They just happened to have all this soil ready to place into the planter beds and some flowers to plant. It was me talking to press about the project. Yeah, and I'm just ending with a couple nice texture shots of the piece. Why am I not a hip-hop architect? It's more of a sense of refusal to be put into a subcategory. Refusal to accept that architecture is only one thing.
Well, that was just wonderful.
Wow. Thank you both for sharing your work with us tonight. And to the audience, this is meant to be a conversation, so I will be your transmitter and cipher. Please start typing your thoughts in the Q&A box, not the chat. And they don't have to be well-formulated essays or finished questions. Thoughts will do to kind of prompt a conversation. I'm sure many of you have questions and reactions to this really important work. So while our kind audience is typing their thoughts in here for a conversation, I will jump right in as questions accumulate. Architecture's history is difficult and often immoral. It has been the tool of nation building, of cultural appropriation, of colonization, extraction. And in these histories, people in power have engaged architecture to construct cultural histories in order to legitimize power and to continue to keep racial and to create racial hierarchies. So architecture constructs, reifies, and legitimizes. And it does this mostly with objecthood, with its own references, with precedents. I know there's an ongoing conversation about precedent and histories and references. And this continues to be architecture's way to maintain certain histories and certain power structures in place. And in both of your work, you argue that, as Sekou finished this presentation with this idea, that if architecture can be many things, not one thing, then perhaps it can instrumentalize other structures, cultures, voices, materials, practices, and histories. Histories that are multiple, that are authored by the many, and by not specifically by non-Western European centrality. And so I'd like to start with Sekou. Your work is interested in rethinking how architecture can be a space for cultural identity. This comes up a lot with the project in Syracuse. And most of the projects you've shown also really offer architecture as a background for continued engagement. It's not finished, but it's willing to host changing and layered narratives and activities. So the act of glitching the Cartesian grid, right? Your own originating drawing for the Chicago Biennale, slicing the cube of logistical efficiency of capitalist regimes like the shipping container, or the aesthetic project of liquid material agglomeration of spray paint onto the what is imagined as an idealized meaning of a power washed masonry wall. You're rethinking and testing disciplinary terminology in physical space at one-to-one proof of concept scale with the real project. So in terms of disciplinary methods, can you talk a bit about your process and at what point does it argue against the over-intellectualized disciplinary theory that you mentioned in your presentation?
Yeah, thanks Ursula. That's a big question, a lot to unpack, and especially in conversation with the work that Azra showed. I think that that the starting point of almost all the work is to question everything, to question why these assumptions are assumptions, why there's a kind of default to the understanding of why and how we do things. And this comes in direct response to my upbringing, right? My architectural upbringing, which is in very, very well-established ways of architectural thinking from Cornell to Harvard. And those aren't easy tropes to break, but they have to constantly be questioned. So I in some ways, it's kind of a internal fight. Like I am fighting the parts of myself that have been trained and have been beaten into submission, that really adopted all of that wholeheartedly. When you're young and impressionable and you're learning what architecture is and you're being fed all this stuff, you just take it as doctrine and assume that, you know, Richard Meyer is God and Corbusier is the second coming of Jesus. And these are the people that you have to follow. And at some point in your career, it probably doesn't happen all at once, but it happens in a kind of cumulative layered process. You start to realize that the things that you're taught might not be all true, and they might be questioned. And then once you start to see behind the veil of academia, you start to understand how insecure everybody is about all of their work and how nobody has the answers, and that academia is really a space for, ideally a space for exploration and interrogation. And we should all be questioning all of these things all the time.
Wow. Yeah. And I think this is, I love the conversation. And I have a prompt for Azra, but I see a question by Kasim Shepherd here that I think makes a lot of sense, and it's a good segue to the academic or academic context. He says, you both teach, so how can improvisation and adaptation in unfinished form be more meaningfully incorporated into pedagogy, especially in context of indeterminate and collaboratively produced form? And how can we bring these ideas into practice? And I think either of you can jump in.
I'll let Azra go ahead.
Great question. Thank you, Kasim. Hello. Hello, Beth. Yeah, I think it's a beautiful idea, and many architects, I'm sure, also here in the audience, are working with these tools. I mean, one is a kind of canon of architectural teaching and approaches that you learn and that are maybe geared towards professional practice and working in a architectural office and you know, learning how to build a building. At least my training was such in a very technical university. And at that time, I quickly realized at the end of my studies, you know, this cannot be in, especially after I finished my undergraduate thesis, that was documenting the largest informal market in the Balkans, which was all about improvisation and adaptation and kind of reconstruction and reuse of these pre-existing infrastructures that were left from former Yugoslavia and then surrounded by a minefield. There was a little city evolving. And I think there's a lot one can learn from places like this. I think just studying, and this is what we did in the refugee camp, first understand and document what is actually useful. And this was, at least in our case, an educational tool. So for the MIT students who participated in this research project, but also for myself as a, at that time, architecture student working on the Bosnian cases, it was learning about improvisation, reuse of places instead of building anew, and what can one take from these places. In the case of the refugee camp, Azrak, that I showed in the presentation, we can learn a lot. I mean, first of all, we can learn what is missing. People invent things that are not provided. So what are actually human needs? And this was quite valuable in our courses at MIT, to where we are, you know, this is an engineering and science known school where we kind of want to solve problems of the world. But at times we need to unlearn some of these approaches, and reverse engineering, refugee inventions, was a way of actually doing that. Okay, is it that you go and design these perfect refugee shelters and ship them there? Is that the kind of class that we want to give? Or is it what can we learn and what can we unlearn from our own discipline? So definitely, I think, yeah, this is an important possibility.
Yeah, unlearning is key. And if we all recognize that in order to really move forward and innovate in any way, you have to unlearn before you can really learn something new. And to answer the question that was posed, improvisation and adaptation are virtually impossible within the standard structure of architectural services, you know, the delivery of architectural services, or really impossible within the structure of how we structure architectural education, right? It's not really something that's part of the process. And this is why we have to go outside the discipline. This is why I had to go to hip hop to actually learn how improvisation and adaptation actually work in order to find ways of instituting them, those ideas within the architectural context. And I'm still figuring that out. I'm still finding ways, like I still imagine what it would be like to build a building without a set of drawings, or to use the set of drawings as just a starting point and completely improvise based on that, have a complete like call and response, like a DJ and a B-boy between the architect and the GC and just come up with something on the fly. And that can keep changing and adapting as we go along. That's a kind of pipe dream for me. I was really blown away by Azra's project with the little laser cut tiles, that this is something that's being constructed and unconstructed, destructed constantly, and that it's never in a singular state. And I think if architecture were to emulate hip hop in any way, that it would cease to imagine that the architectural object is this fixed thing. It's always something that's changing and being reshaped by its users and its perceivers.
Listen, if I may, I was so inspired by your work when you said you were talking about care and self-care, and you mentioned joy also as a part of the, if I may ask if you could elaborate a little bit on that. You know, what role does joy play in, you know, community building and these processes also learning and unlearning and building a community?
Joy is something that we're always seeking, and joy goes beyond happiness, right? And one definition that I've heard is that, you know, happiness usually is something that is a result of external items. Like, you're looking to something, you buy a car because you think it's going to make you happy, you get a house because it's going to make you happy, enter a relationship in order to seek happiness. But joy is something that's always generated internally, something that comes from within. And when I talk about joy in that context, in my work, I'm really was also referencing in that specific context to Black joy. That's something that is developed from inside a community, that they have to understand and appreciate the conditions of their environments in order to find joy within that, instead of trying to seek something outside. And usually in an architectural way, what that starts to look like is people aspire to a Western European ideal and try to find that, incorporate that within their work. But I think there's a clear energy that is inherent to Black cultures that is really untapped in most architectural circles, that we have to find from within. And I think that's where joy comes, and the rest of that quotes that after joy is where we find real freedom.
Wow. So Sean Anderson, of course, wrote an essay for a question. He's amazing. I think Sean and I must be on the same wavelength. I was just recently reread Mabel Wilson's conversation with Julianne Rose that was published a few years ago in Art Forum, where she discusses this issue of the tools of architecture as a discipline that will not allow us to imagine a different world as long as these tools remain unchanged. So since the discipline as an architectural discipline was a humanist invention, right, also invented these tools and methods to uphold certain power structures. And so I was going to prompt you to think about which tools you would obliterate and replace right away. But I kind of wanted that to linger in your mind as I transcribe Sean's brilliant question. He's really excited to see and hear your work here today. Both of you, he says, access histories, narratives, and acts of displacement to open up new spaces for architects and architecture to consider value, propriety, agency. Yet, as we all know, institutions, be it global aid, governance organizations, educational or cultural, are very slow to amplify, if not acknowledge, these significant presence and futures in order to maintain aspects of power, which is kind of what what I was just mentioning. So does your work subvert power, or does it create new forms that undo traditional definitions, structures, and types? What would you say if you were to write a critique of your own work?
I would say that it reclaims power. was having this conversation in my class, just my seminar class, just on Wednesday. And a student was responding to one of the readings that we had, that was, you know, we're pairing a reading about Nipsey Hussle with a reading from the Venice, the 2019 Venice Biennale, the Dimensions of Citizenship book by Anna Maria Leon. And she was saying that, she said that it's really helping people to recognize their agency, not to gain agency or claim agency. They're recognizing their agency, that people already have that agency. It's already there. So it's not that people are creating new power or dismantling power structures to take their power. It's just becoming aware that this power already exists, and finding ways of using that once you now know that you have it, right? You know, I try to think of some kind of analogy for a superhero movie, like when you recognize that there's this power that exists, what do you do with it, right?
Yeah, I subscribe to this same idea, like you. I think I locate the political agency of my work. I mean, I'm not necessarily an activist, although I have some activist project, but most of them are about making things visible or putting, reframing questions and the ways in which we think about certain things. And in, you know, if power frames possibilities in this way, we have the possibility to reframe the question and open up people's eyes and look at the problem in a different way. For example, with these, all these pro and counter mosque discussions in Europe, the architectural argumentation of that became really so reductive, and it was kind of cornering these already marginalized Muslim communities that were like trying to carve out a little bit money and make their community space and build a place of worship. And then the anti-mosque protests is saying like, well, you know, this doesn't fit into a local landscape. And what are they doing in the response? They will come with, you know, kind of nationalist nostalgia and Ottoman references and kind of architecture that really is rooted in kind of colonial stereotypes of their own identity and kind of subscribing and perpetuating stereotypes about themselves. And so for me, coming in, on the one hand, it's shedding light at the problem, like, come on, this is not about fittingness of architectural building in a local context, but it's really about racism and xenophobia and Islamophobia. On the one hand, on the other hand, critique towards the Muslim community itself to say, why do you think this mosque needs to look this way? Who said that? Is it because you saw it in a calendar of a Turkish bank that sent you this type of imagery? What kinds of stereotypes and possibilities are you perpetuating? And so I think knowing these complexities and investigating them and kind of opening up questions in multiple directions allows for somewhat deconstruction, but also empowerment and for people to then build places with what they're really about.
Yeah. I think, I mean, you also, Azra, you've been able to be present in these really contested contexts, both sort of politically, but also as a physical condition. So humanitarian aid is generally is fraught, right? It accompanies military occupation and then nation reconstruction post-conflict, grafting external logics to local conditions. And so what I think is really amazing about your work is that it engages the material manifestations of aid head on, and then asks these important questions about displaced histories and how these material systems might be co-opted to safeguard those cultural histories and those cultural practices. So it's not the simplistic idea of, as you mentioned, like basic needs of shelter. It's really about a smart co-opting to be able to take histories with you, right? For people who are displaced. And so I wonder there, like, where do you locate the knowledge and expertise of the designer in this kind of very sort of fragile context, right? Or unpredictable, what is the place of the designer there? At which point in this kind of histories do you enter?
And who is also the designer, the one trained in the West? I mean, it was a very complicated place to work in, of course, with a lot of ethical concerns. And I mean, just the fact that we can leave the camp and they cannot is a problem. And then who is the designer? I mean, we, these people living in a camp, when you saw these inventions, these are not formally trained designers. Most of them, had different professions. Some people were, tourist guides and teachers, and some were engineers, and some were farmers. But they are also designers, and they have learned from each other and learned from the very oppressive environment to kind of transform it into a livable environment. And so there is that kind of designer, and then there is a let's say me or my students as designers coming in. For us, of course, when I first came to the camp, I saw a lot of issues that could be really addressed with design expertise. But then the question came, who is supposed to do that? And is it ethical to insert ourselves in, or where do we contribute? How can we best contribute? So some contributions that we made were kind of knowledge transfer, and everyone is teaching and learning something. Then some was design propositions to the humanitarian agencies too. And I think they already, for example, UNHCR, even if we are critiquing them here, there are many ways in which they have actually learned from the people and have, these are also really huge, complex problems. 1,000 people arrive per day. You have to put them somewhere, give them food, shelter, and so on. And these initial provisional solutions were then dysfunctional. They learned that, okay, you actually cannot just enter into the bedroom. This is a different culture. People also need a kitchen. They started building kitchen outside. And so the agency started learning from the people and separating and inserting walls and kind of rearranging the shelters. And there were a lot of learning processes, I think, also the organizations learned too. And I think where we were most useful were to connect the dots between different groups, whether it was through workshops that were about the code of ethics and a kind of what one group thinks is ethical and in this context is not in this context, and bringing people across disciplines from journalists, humanitarian workers, designers, and camp residents to give their perspective about the other ethical issues they see about the design, right? So that was one, I think, place for designer to connect the dots and to ask these different questions. The other is to amplify voices, and the one creating solutions for themselves, but also to kind of disseminate that knowledge to others to learn from. And for us, it was through the book, my co-editors, Melina Filippo and Rafat Mazyub, whose credits were unfortunately eaten in the video, as I just saw. I want to credit them here. The book is now taking that knowledge from the camp and actually bringing it all around the world, and also to policymakers, humanitarian agencies, and the US State Department. So I think that's another sphere where one can be helpful. But one is always left with a bitter taste that, yes, what have you achieved? How much can you actually change as an individual, and what constitutes success in these kinds of impossible environments?
Thank you. Thank you for attempting that question. So I have a question by Pamela here. I don't know who it is directed towards. And so if it speaks to either of you, what's the duration of these structures and how do they evolve or change over time, evolving their own histories? Or are they one-offs to excite and challenge existing structures, much as fair and pilgrimage sites do?
That sounds like an Azra question. Unless, I mean, the only structures that could be referred to in my presentation would be the Chicago Architecture Biennial project, which was initially expected to be or intended to be a temporary installation, right? As all of the installations there were. So from October when it opened to December when they were closing up, but this is one that actually ended up serving the community, and they're keeping it, and it's there semi-permanently. As a matter of fact, if anybody's going to the AIA conference in Chicago in June, they're going to be giving tours of that project at that point. So that is only has that kind of life cycle in a temporary installation biennial situation because of the process that we went through to produce it. And it's my first attempt at really challenging the typical notion of community engagement, where you go to a community, you have a session with post-it notes and they tell you what they like and you circle things that all kind of seem to align. And then you go back to the studio and you design and say, okay, here's what you told us that you wanted. But instead it was a real back and forth with the organizers and looking at what they had, amplifying some of the pieces that they had, working with them on the programming, the layout, the process, and then making sure to involve the kids in their program in the actual installation work. It's a whole different process when somebody fabricates something in a shop, brings it to a studio and plops it down, than when people in the community actually put their hands on it. Now they feel ownership over it, and now they feel like they are an integral part of the process. Now it's part of something that they produced. Every time they go by it, they're going to be telling their friends, I helped do that, right? I made that. And that's so integral at all scales of architecture. So as I move up in scale with this idea, I really want the process to expand as well. And I can see a lot of parallels between that and the project Azra did with the tiles in the back, in her background.
Thank you for the question. Shall I answer or
do you? If you'd like, yes, sure.
In my case, I mean, you know, there's the Memory Matrix project. It was a temporary art installation, but the tiles are there, and the project took different forms in a number of different locations in Ramallah, in Amman, in Manila. We created different constellations that were speaking to local heritage, and then the whole thing looked very different. Not, it didn't have the Palmyra shape, but something that spoke to the local issues. So the duration there was determined by the nature of the project. It's a temporary intervention. I have other projects that are longer term, and the question is also of longevity, right? So some things, for example, the Diandal Moshe, the wearable piece that I have shown, yes, I mean, this is a piece of clothing. We can call it architecture. It's also fashion. It's a, you know, boundary object of its sort. But that thing entered the educational books, high school education in Germany. It was quite a famous art project that was shown in a number of different museums all across Germany. People got interested, especially Catholic Church and Jewish museums. And are very intrigued by it because of this transcultural aesthetic component. And then the piece translated into an educational project, what used to be like a performative piece and engagement with people and deconstructing some of the very dense debates into, you know, there's a documentary movie about the traditional costumes, which is really about like nationalism and history of, related to that dress. And here you see this piece destabilizing those ideas. It is part of the high school education. And I think here you have a different kind of longevity that I think architecture also has, not only as a built form, but as this kind of transient form. I have one piece that is built. We will see how it does. It's in the Islamic cemetery in Alta in Austria, prayer space that I designed within the cemetery built by Austrian architect Bernardo Bader. That one is going to have its own, you know, story, but it is a kind of beginning of a European Islamic, Western European Islamic heritage, let's say. And, you know, it needs time to show how it's going to do.
Amazing. I think, well, since this is the Emerging Voices series, which, as Anne mentioned in the beginning, highlights work that has developed a unique voice, but that we're going to continue to watch because it will have implications, right, and larger impact in the discipline. I'd love to perhaps end with this wanting to know what is next for you.
Try to take over the world.
Right.
Same thing we do every night, Pinky. so there's a lot that's on the drawing board, literally and figuratively, right now. And each of them I realize are about changing structures of some sort, right? So you know, from plug-in, like prefabricated plug-in units to transform garages into ADUs, to rethink how ADUs or construction models are working, to you know, a multi-unit low-income housing project that's really not a low-income housing project because it's empowering, it's creating a new model that's empowering the homeowners to become the developers of the project. So they actually are involved in the entire design and execution process, and they control the funding and the affordability of the project, to what I'm doing at UNC Charlotte, where we're transforming the urban design program here as a microcosm of the School of Architecture's program. So it's everything is transforming some given structure, and I'm working on bringing it all under a singular umbrella within a platform for change that is really inspired by the work that I've done over the last 8 years on hip hop architecture.
Wow. So yes, take over the world, right?
Yeah, take over the world.
Azra, what is next for you?
I will join you in your efforts. and a range of things. I'm drowning. survived the year. Well, you know, I would really love to continue developing this T-Serai project, because we, you know, a lot of the work that I've shown, it takes forever to develop, because what I do and what I then do with my team and the Future Heritage Lab is to, well, first research a phenomenon, then create a community around it, then, you know, work jointly across different locations. Now we have a proof of concept. We have the pedagogical dimension of the project. So we are launching an online course that on design and scarcity that is focused on these lessons learned from Azra and Zaatari refugee camps with refugees as co-educators. But then one part of it is to then kind of scale up this T-Serai idea. We have as a prototype, the proof of concept is there, the model is there, but I think it really has this other capacity that is not yet fully developed of kind of scaling up and changing the way in which humanitarian aid is sourced. For example, why do we need to, you know, ship things from Switzerland when we could actually source them locally? Can textile industry that is so lucrative and pollutant at the same time be having a kind of part in the game and support the livelihood of these people? In what ways can one enter into the livelihood education camps in order to for people to kind of maybe create their own economic setups? I mean, this is very complicated because they kind of, you know, don't have access to work and any possibility to earn their own money. So not even a co-op, you know, there are models, but you cannot apply them because they are not allowed to do anything. But maybe we are, and there are ways in which one can kind of hire the people to work for themselves or subvert the systems in some way. So that's next for me to try to test it. And then on the institutional side, you know, I started directing the Art Culture Technology program in September last year. So with my colleagues together, I have really a great group of colleagues working in similar and if not even harder context, you know, join forces in battling some of the larger questions that and concerns that we are all facing: the climate crisis, the extinction of species, the survival of the planet, the nuclear threat, and you know, being at an institution that is also producing weapons and technologies of mass destruction, we have the ethical responsibility to do something, and also, you know, educate and inspire young generations not to kind of fall into the hopelessness and disparity of doomsday scenarios that are given to all of us, but really acknowledge that we do have the power to change things, and we just need to put our work together and our different skills. It's not about individuals anymore. I think we need to kind of shift the gear there and learn from each other. And there are so many genius people. I mean, just in your program, the Emerging Voices, such a fantastic group of architects and designers have come together. And I hope they'll have a chance to collaborate in the future. And you know, not just see each other on Zoom, but really join forces literally on the ground, because we will need to do that.
Yeah, wow, thank you. You're both amazing human beings. And if you're not a good human, you have no business being an architect. So it's been a pleasure. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ursula.
Thank you, Ursula. Thank you all the people in the audience.
And I can't think of a better, more open-ended way to end the series, which actually technically is not quite over, because there are a series of interviews that our league staff, led by our editorial director, Sarah Wessler, has conducted with the speakers, and four of them have been published, but there are four to come. And then videos of all of these presentations will also be published on the league's website in the coming weeks. So we thank you very much for joining us this week, and we look forward to seeing you at other league programs in the future.